Hey folks, have you ever wondered how network filters work in a subquery? Well, stick around and I'll show you how. The first thing I want to do is let's jump into VS Code and we'll create the starter project. We run subql init, let's call this network filter example, accept all the defaults, and there we have it initialized on the left hand side. Let's jump into the project and I'll just run yarn install first. While that is running, let me open up the manifest file here, and you can see we've got our data source, and this is pointing to the Polkadot mainnet endpoint. Now, what if you want to point to, say, Kusama Network or another endpoint? Well, you can do this quite easily by just replacing this line. If we go into the documentation, for example, in the FAQ section, we can see what is the endpoint for Kusama. So I can copy this out. And then I can paste it in here. But this is a bit troublesome. It takes a bit of time and things could be improved. So that is why inside subquery projects, if I open up any project here, so this one for example, and go into settings, deploy a new version, this is why you see we've got this option to override the network endpoint. If you leave it blank, it takes the default from the project YAML file. So this file we saw here, this line. Otherwise, if I paste something like this, the Kusama testnet, then this will be used instead. And this is pretty neat because it allows me to deploy different versions pointing to different endpoints for different purposes. Testing, for instance. However, let's take this to the next level, because if we look at the code, what if I want to provide slightly different parameters, such as a different starting block for the two different endpoints? Well, it turns out I can do this as well. Let me go into the documentation here, and on the left-hand side, under Create a Project, click on the manifest file. And then on the right hand side here, let's jump to network filters. So it's here where you can, as a user, deploy your project to either testnet or mainnet environments. However, between the networks, various options can be different. As mentioned, the start block. So what we can do is define different details for these data sources in the manifest file that we can use across different networks. And here is the example here, where we go ahead and provide one data source called Polkadot, another one called Kusama, and then effectively we have a definition file up above pointing our mappings to the definition, but inside our data source we can provide different parameters. So let's jump in and take a look at this. What I'll do is let's go and copy this data source here, and then I'll paste it down here below, and then I'll call this, say, Polkadot endpoint, and I'll call this one here Kusama endpoint. Now what I'll do is let's go yarn code gen, generating the code. And this confirms that it still works. But what you'll notice is that it won't actually do anything useful. You'll also notice that we've got some redundancies here. So the handler portion is defined twice. And as always in programming, you don't want to define the same thing multiple times. So let's go ahead and cut this, get rid of this, and I'm going to call this definition. And then paste it down here. I've got a tab in to keep the formatting, And I'll just confirm if this is singular or plural. It's plural, so let me put an S. And there's also another level here called mappings. And this is where I provide the name. Let me go ampersand, which is the key symbol that you need to define the name of the definition. And I'll call this global definition, like so. And I'll tab that in, save this file. And this means I can delete the handler up above. Now, what we do need to do is, if I go back to the documentation, you'll notice I need to refer or point my data source mapping to the definition mapping. So I basically just go asterisk and then say global definition. Same thing for this one below, global definition. Save this and let me run yarn code gen. Now you see I get an error, and if I look at the reason, it says unidentified alias global definition. Now this is because I'm actually using my definition before I've defined it. So let me go ahead and cut this and reorder this and place it up above. Let's save this. Let me run yarn code gen again, and you can see there's another error where the end of stream or document separator is expected. So the formatting is not quite right. And what you'll notice is that the name needs to be tabbed in. So it needs to be in line. These ones should be okay, but I can bring it back one tab just to keep it nice and consistent. Now let's try running this again, and success. So what I've effectively done is gone ahead and created my definition, and then I've created my data source where I can customize it, and my mappings repoints back to my global definition. So I can now say, let's start the polka dot endpoint at a block height of 1,000 and maybe Kusama at 15,000, say. You'll also notice in the documentation that you can add a filter on the data source to decide which data source to run on each network. So for example, this one here, we use filter spec name equals polka dot, and same down below with Kusama. So indeed we'll do this. Let's go spec name Kusama, and the same for the one above, and I'll just copy this in like so. So again, just double checking yarn code gen, no errors, and then I can go yarn build as well. Great, there we go, success. Now just a brief recap, what we've done is we've expanded our understanding of the manifest file by having different data sources, having a global definition mapping, so we can go ahead and change the endpoint as we saw in SubQuery project. So when this is overridden by, say, the Kusama endpoint, it will then come down here, look at the Kusama data source, read in the parameters from here, and then refer back to the global definition that we write only once. As always, thanks for watching. Catch you on the next video.